So I have to admit, I've been privileged to work with a lot of people in project management. And the gentleman that Andrew just referred to, Ray Ju, is absolutely one of them. And as a matter of fact, was very encouraging. I said, I am thinking about doing this at some point in time. And reached out to me and said, you know, if you're truly thinking about doing this, what's wrong with now? What's wrong with now?
That sounds exactly like something Ray would say.
Doesn't it? Which also provides a wonderful segue. I know that it originally in here, there was a little note that said, okay, Kimi's going to talk about da-da-da-da for... Well, you've been listening to me on and off for 2 days, and I think by now you've seen a very practical and pragmatic explanation in action of why I thought doing this was so important, and also why I thought it was so important to do it now, because we're facing some pretty wonderful possibilities at the beginning of every year, to Andrew's point. I always feel like it's an opportunity to reboot for those of us who still do that every once in a while, to reboot. And of course, for me, it's much easier because my birthday isn't until August, and who wants to wait until then? Ray's also the person that connected me with our next speaker, Elaine Law. And Elaine is someone who I have used this phrase about her in the past before. Elaine is a bundle of energy, smarts, verve, and perception. And frankly, I want to be her when I grow up, but I'm not sure I'm ever going to make it. Like many of us, for reasons that may or may not be politically correct to call out. Yes. Ray Ju, PMP. Like many of us, for reasons that, you know, skirt the line of political correctness, we are seen as something that we're not. Preconceptions are made of us. My personal favorite, fair warning, political incorrectness coming up, was when somebody met me for the first time back in the days when we didn't do video conferencing that much. I happened to stand behind him while he was describing to a bunch of our colleagues on a team we'd been working on for 3 years. And he was describing me. Steve had this idea of who he was going to meet when I walked into that door in Minneapolis. And somebody said, so what do you think? You know, everybody gets this picture. We're used to get this picture back in the day of what the person on the other end of the phone looked like. And Steve was absolutely sure he knew who I was. He said, well, you know, Kimi's very forceful. She's a very California girl. So I figure she's probably about 5'9", probably really athletic because, you know, she always comes from strength. And I don't think you do that without being physically fit and athletic as well. And I'm figuring, you know, California, she's got to be blonde. Well, Steve wasn't at all what I thought either. I thought he'd have hair, to use the line from Red. And I tapped him on the shoulder, which did require this. And I said, wow, I think you might be disappointed. And he turned around and the first thing he said was, oh my, you're not blonde? And I know that in his heart of hearts, he was actually thinking something else as well, because all of us have to work with the fact that the first impressions that we make aren't always who we are. And sometimes it's funny, but sometimes it's not. Elaine has overcome that and she has triumphed over it, but it wasn't easy and it wasn't only a single step. Elaine, you have the floor.
Thank you for that introduction. And again, with Kimi's, disclaimer, I'm definitely going to say that the topic that I'm going to discuss will cover a little bit of discrimination, right? Some assumptions And it almost ageism as well. You know, I realized that as I've gotten older, how that could apply. So my session here is really open in the sense that I only prepared some minor notes. I really wanted to share the spirit of something that had happened to me in hopes that you can share it either with others as they are growing through their career, or even now in this moment, if anything that I might share with you sparks to help you with your personal growth. So I'm just gonna look at my notes. Actually, that's not working very well while I look at you guys at the same time, but I will try to have them both together. So, you know, Kimi and I spent a few minutes together over the past few weeks, and she came up with a really great title for this. And it boils down to this, the fallacy of first impressions, right? And let me set the backdrop of how we're basing this story and then bring you to where I am today. So I am 50 years old. And when I was starting my career, I was a little bit late. I was in my back half of the 20s. So I was 26, 27. And I was a buyer at a well-known pharmaceutical company, forensic drugs testing. And I went to collect some guests that were there to see me. And so I collected them at the front door, and it was a very long walk back to my office. And as I was leaving them, I was talking with them, making small talk, how was your travels, blah, 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 right? And then I walk into this great office, a 12 by 12 office, and then I sit behind the chair. And then they both went, oh. It was so funny to me because they thought I was the admin leading them to the person that they were going to see, which I found funny. And maybe I didn't notice that our correspondence was only over email, but I had swore that I spoke with them on the phone. So I thought they would recognize my voice. So I didn't shake their hand when I saw them and say, hi, I'm Elaine. You're waiting for me. I just said, you're waiting for Elaine. Yes. Well, come with me. So they had no idea that it was me. So in a couple of points, I'd like to share with you today that the journey that I went through in being perceived as the admin to instead being received as the president of the San Francisco Bay Area chapter for PMI. So that said, a couple of things to just talk about. Please know I'll take questions anytime. Just wave your hand, right? If you want to say something, or Kimi, if I go a little too far, just say, pull it back a little, girl, right?
Well, okay. I should also note, Amaria is going to, is doing the producing, and she is really good at keeping an eye on chat. So if a question comes up, also, because we've had a couple of folks, we're in the Midwest, the weather doesn't always treat our telecom facilities very nicely. We have a couple of folks who don't have audio, or it just does interesting things to everybody's audio. So I've encouraged people to put things in chat, and Amaria will, you know, you'll hear her voice and she'll say, we did have a question on, and so that's how you usually get it.
Thank you. As this lint is like really bothering me right now, it always is that, right? It's like, here we go. Okay, so in my heart, I always say when I think about leadership and growth, right, that you want to be valued for who you intrinsically are. I've always wanted to just show up as me and expect people to see what I see or see what I feel, right? And that's a fallacy, right? In no way do people grant you that when you first show up. It's just realistic, right? They don't know you. They don't know where you've been. They don't know what you're about to say. And so perception is reality, to quote my favorite car maker. And that's okay, right? Because there are things that you can do. But the point that I'm trying to actually make is inside, right? You always want to feel that they, well, at least I, they should receive you in what you believe that you are. And the things that you can do to help that happen is this, right? I'm going to show you a picture. Please don't laugh, but you know, maybe you will.
Or put your mic on mute when you do.
This is me that first year when I had that problem. You see that little face?
Oh my goodness.
I'm 29 in that photo. But you can tell, it's easy for them to perceive me not who I am at the age and maturity of what I was doing, right? This is the actual year I was working with Kimi's friend, Ray Ju, right? And, you know, you can tell by the keyboard and the clothes, right? This is the late 90s. Oh, bless that. Okay, so, but then it's like, look at me today. I'm really not that different, right? Not that different. Better haircut. Yeah.
I do like the haircut.
Better haircut. Yeah. So here are a couple things, right? Show up for the job at hand. I know that's difficult right now, especially with Zoom and being at home. We're all encouraged to be more relaxed because we're not getting up to go to work and to get dressed. But please don't use that too much, right? Look at her. Look at, she looks beautiful. She's got a necklace, a red shirt, a collared shirt, the whole thing. She did her hair today, right? She did her face today, right?
You're not supposed to tell them that's not how I always look.
Yeah. You know, try to show up for the job at hand, right? You can be like maybe different from the waist down these days, but from the waist up, you know, try to show up for the job at hand. And I mean that in the most positive way, right? Think about your company culture. Fold that in, right? At Audi, right, we're the sexy car people, right? Our office attire really aligned with our sexy cars. Like people at the Audi branch offices, dapper. I loved going to work. You know, Kimi knows me. I like to dress up. I like to like have these great things and have my hair done and my lipstick on. That's just me, right? But my company culture also was like that. And it was good for me because I fit in that company culture, right? So think about that as you're actually going to work, right? You don't have to wear the stuffy suit anymore, right? But figure out that middle ground, right? The one thing that I've used often, and I probably even used it with Kimi one time, is set the stage for the conversation you want to have. Kimi reminds me of this moment where I actually helped her in a very personal moment during one of our teaching engagements. Well, her teaching engagement, because I was actually attending her engagement. And, you know, it was very interesting where I said something to her. I actually meant it. And I stood there and waited for her to actually follow through, right, with it. And then I, you know, walked her out. So, you know, set the stage. We went out. Yeah. So that's a couple of highlights, right, of what to do to switch from being perceived to being received, right? Another layer on that is to think before you get there, how do you want to be perceived? And that's very important now with the use of Zoom, because we all arrive at the same moment in video. And we don't know where those people's eyes are going and who they're actually looking at when we're talking, right? So I might be talking right now, but you might be looking at Bobby in that fabulous cafe that I want to be in with him. And I had wished greatly that that was real. Then I realized it was a Zoom background and got a little sad. But the point is, right, that you don't know who they're looking at. So prepare yourself on how you want to be received at the beginning of the meeting, right? One item that I was even afraid to use until later in life was to be brave also with your feedback. So how do you want to be received is directly tied with what you say and the feedback in the moment that you're participating, right? So earlier last year, you know, it's really hard to tell time now, maybe it's been 2 years, I went to the Silicon Valley open space. And in that open space for PMI, in that open space, they asked about how we were making connections with leaders, how we could speak to them and find a reason. And I used the be brave feedback because some people like to just sit back and listen. I'm all with that. That's great, right? But if you're trying to grow your network, like if this is the goal that you're working on, try to grow your network, try to grow your leadership, you have to be brave and step up and ask for that time, ask for that feedback, right? That's how you can be received, right? Received by that other person, because you're stepping up to the podium in the moment and you're asking for that spotlight, right? You got to use that. The last one is actually about impressions, right? This is the best part, I think, of this chat, because I'm going to break down some fallacies that we might think about that happen during impressions, right? Number one, my friend Ken Grady gave that to me, and I think you may have seen a video interview from him with me, and he said the following words: people are not born with the book of answers. I love that one. It's a fallacy on first impressions, right? Like, you're Mr. President, you have all the answers. No, you don't. But as a leader, it's okay to not have the book of answers, right? In my line of work with Agile, there's two answers that are always correct. It's either yes or I don't know. Only two answers. Yes, I don't know. Not born with the book of answers. Wow, I love that one. Okay, another one is speak in the audience's language. So consultants use it in a different way, which is called meet them where they are, right? So you meet them where they are in the vernacular that they're using, thinking it from their departmental view, and trying to not use your vernacular and use theirs. So an example would be something like, from an Audi perspective, we talk about this thing called Maiko all the time. And to me, when I hear the word Maiko, like, yeah, where'd Mike go? Right, you know, you don't know that that actually means something. But Maiko means model year changeover. And so why didn't you say model year changeover? It's like, how are we supposed to know that? So speak to people without acronyms and speak to them in the way that they need. You need to speak so that you are heard by them, right?
Elaine, and haven't you noticed that most people don't even realize that they're actually, in many ways, trilingual, because they can speak to children, they can speak to people of different generations, they can speak to people that they've never met differently than they speak to people that they've known for years. But until then, when you say speak to people where they are, there's this sudden, oh no, does that mean I have to analyze them? Well, no, you kind of already do that.
Yeah, it's really weird. But when the moment comes where you actually realize that that's what you're doing already, or that's how you need to adjust, it's either a great, amazing epiphany, or you realize, oh, I've been doing that all along. But thank you for reminding me, right? Yeah. Okay. I love using the words be bold, right? And this lady who called me out just now as the introduction, lovely, in a lovely way, I find that maybe my natural state is more bold than most, right? Perhaps it is, right? Because I just ask. If I need to know something, I ask, right? So be bold. Lead with who you really are. Don't worry about people judging you, right? Because they're either going to perceive you as like the quiet one, perhaps, or receive you as the person you really want to be, right? So be yourself, right? Don't worry about trying to be something else. Yeah. Now, my lovely friend here asked me to prepare two things that you could take away. And the first one is do the research to meet them where you are, meet them where they are, right? So do a little research, find out what's going on. What is this meeting? What is the forum? Like, you know, what's the agenda, right? So do a little research. You might need a little bit of deliberate action there to figure that out. And this last one is my most favorite, which is be ready to not be ready, because you don't have the book of answers and you don't know what other people are thinking. So you're going to have to not be ready. And that's okay. You can still be a leader and lead very well if you're not ready.
Now, Elaine, as I said, we've got a few folks who have been having difficulties with the technology. That never happens, right? And one question that, so my text box has been blowing up for 2 days now. One question that I got via text because the individual had to actually scoot was, what is the first thing that you do in a room to demonstrate that you are to show your level of power, to demonstrate your leadership in the situation or in that particular team meeting? What is the first thing that you do to demonstrate that?
That is a great question. And you're going to be amazed at how simple this answer is. Eye contact, right? Smile, eye contact, because you're going to draw attention to you, right? And you're going to be able to show people that you're actually there. You're showing up for the job at hand, right? You're not like over here, like waiting for the meeting to start. Right? Like, do you see the difference of just what I did? Just right there. Yeah.
Which actually brings up a question that I've been fielding a lot lately. How have you been noticing it? What have you been getting as you try to make eye contact with people through a camera? I mean, we're looking at cameras now. We're not, if I were to look at where you show up on my screen, I feel like I'm making eye contact with you, except that now it looks like I'm not looking at anybody. How have you been positioning that or dealing with that? And have you noticed that it's changed the dynamics for you in meetings?
Zoom has changed the entire world because we all know that 80% of communication is body language. This is a fact. It's in every PM book there is on the market, right? It may be higher in some other books, right? So you have to adapt. And sometimes adapting means doing crazy things like this. Is it working? It's not working.
I'm not sure. I'm not seeing your screen.
Hi.
You oh my me? God.
Hi.
Nope.
Is it working?
Yeah, it is.
Right? So this is where we are, right?
So are you saying that despite the fact that sometimes people get the wrong impression of us, that doesn't mean that they get to rob us of our sense of humor?
Yes. And I do Fun Hat Friday on Zoom for stand-up. Sometimes I wear my hat all day long, right? I'm actually the major facilitator for the entire Audi digital program. So I run large calls across multiple teams. I am the MC. This is like my life. Being an MC is, I don't know how I got this inherited, but my entire career, I've been the MC. And probably you're going, it's obvious, Elaine, how do you not believe this? But so, you know, with my tiny voice, right, I have to run 50 people all at the same time. And so you use the tools that you have. And normally when you're in person, you stand in the middle of the circle, right? Because you're doing scrum of scrum. Right. There's no circle. So how do you know? You stick something on your head, right? So this is where we are, right? I'm looking at this camera at you. Yeah.
No, I love, Vicky also always says, close your eyes and jump in. You can be a leader and not be 100% ready.
Yeah, this is true.
So politically incorrect question coming up.
I love these.
Who do you think suffers the most from the fallacy of first impressions?
As in male or female or just in general?
Anybody. I mean, you could take it down to an example of a generation or an example of, I mean, I couldn't believe Steve thought I was a surfer girl.
Yeah.
California, there you go. But who do you think suffers the most from that?
In my most open honesty, the shy introvert. Are you trying to process that answer?
I am, being such a massively extroversion preference person. Can you help elaborate on that a little bit?
Sure. So in my world, for many years, I've worked with engineers, right? Many engineers are reserved, right? And you don't know who they are for probably the first month that you've met them. And they are shy at often. Their levels of shy will be different, right? But they're often shy, and many of them are introverts, right? And that's, you know, no judgment, it just is, right? The statistics are just that way. And the reason why I think the fallacy hits them the most is we're in a time where people's voices are heard because they get in front and they say what they want to say. We've seen that on TV recently. We've seen that in something, you know, very politically high, right? So if you get in front and you're the loudest, you may look like you're a leader, but you're not, right? 30 days from that moment when the team has formed and is starting to norm, you start to see those others rising, right? But the first impression may not be the case. And maybe your follow-up question is, and how do you handle that, right? I know you. And so how you handle that is you give everyone their moment, right? Everyone. If you find that someone is being reserved and you're the facilitator, you say, "Hi, Susan." I had to scan to see whose name wasn't here. "Hi, Susan. I know you're participating because I can see you, but I haven't heard from you. Is there anything you'd like to share?" Right? Okay. Everyone gets their moment, but you have to give it to them as a project manager, as a facilitator, because they're not going to take it. Okay. They're reserved.
So I recently got a book called Successful Facilitation that was written by a fellow who is very upfront about the fact that he wrote the book because he got tired of getting repeat phone calls from people who said, "Couldn't you just put this all down in a book?" And even though the majority of the book is talking about the difference that the different things that you can do, the behaviors that you can exhibit in rooms when you're facilitating, it has been a little bit different in the virtual environment. So what has the virtual environment done for your style of facilitation or the tools that you use to facilitate discussion from people who are in that situation, but also to keep not a tight rein, but a certain level of control and management of the meeting of different minds and different intellects?
That's a really hard one, right? Because when you're in a room, you can do some of those tricks that I've seen you use, right? If you can hear me clap once, if you can hear me clap twice, right? You're trying to get the room's attention and call to order, right? So you're doing that. And you can't do that over Zoom. The people are just going to think like you're sitting here and, you know, they can't hear you, right? So the difference is setting the ground rules at the beginning of the meeting and who has control, you know, control, right? Who has control, who's facilitating, but also be assertive, right? Because normally I use Zoom to facilitate a demo of the entire program. Right. And they can cue from me seeing me transitioning. Right. We had to move over to Skype and no visual cues, no video, just screen sharing and voiceover. Right. For one time. And I was incredibly angry by the end of that call because people were stepping over me. And so I continued to have to say, please allow me to facilitate this call. Stop talking. Please allow, you know, like I said that probably 10 times. And each time I got louder and louder and louder. And then like so assertive. I've never used my assertive voice that many times in one meeting, right? It's like, you know, so that is the difference, right? They can take visual cues because you'll be going like, right? And people can see you, right? But if they're not seeing you, they...
So
they see this, they don't know what to do.
Now, yesterday, Nar Umerzakova had mentioned that we all have different voices. And it was kind of interesting. It was a phrase that she used because she was talking about use of your voice and how exercises you can do to strengthen it and things that you want to do, not to change who you are and how your voice represents you, but more to strengthen it. And one of the things she talked about, for those and those of you who, keep me honest here, if I misrepresent her, because I know she had to be somewhere else today. She said there's a monarch voice. And that speaks to what Marty's talking about confidence. She said the monarch voice says what it says, is very calm because of it's calm with confidence and certainty. Thank you, Marty, for bringing that up. And in part because it is so. That is simply what it is. It's like saying gravity exists. But I love the example for a woman of small stature, you are powerful. You know, I think that it's kind of interesting because the three women in this particular exchange, Marty, you, and me, none of us are massively tall. And I would be willing to bet, correct me if I'm wrong, that I'm not the only one who's gotten the comment after you walk off of the stage from a keynote and somebody stands up next to you and says, oh, you look taller up there.
I got one better. I couldn't find you through the crowd.
Yeah. But I love it. Dolly Parton and Lady Gaga are my height. Oh my goodness. So
yeah, I don't even break 5 feet, right? So I'm less than 5 feet. And, you know, I also have a very youthful face, right? And my voice is actually quite youthful as well. So, you know, I've had the trifecta. I'm small stature. I have a small voice and I have a youthful face. Right. So it has been very challenging for me. And I've used all of the tricks. I've changed my attire. I've, you know, changed my hair. I've tried to look more sophisticated. I've done public speaking, practiced public speaking so that my voice is clear and confident. And I try very much to not have the not sure stuff going on. Right. Because that leads to the monarch voice that you're talking about. Clear and concise.
I think that's true. And I love the fact that Marty mentioned Dolly Parton and Lady Gaga, because to your point earlier, you absolutely want to strive and work to make sure that people receive you as you truly are, as you genuinely are, and they learn to accept the gift of your strengths and the gift of what you bring to the situation and why your contribution is important. But under no circumstances should you ever lose the curiosity and the whimsy and the sense of humor, because that is so incredibly valuable, says the woman who would probably never express her sense of humor in her dress. I will admit, I'm a little bit stodgy.
I ask you that every time.
I know
try to pull that out from you every time, right? But
She's been trying to get me to loosen up a little bit in my dress for more years than we're going to discuss right now. If you were also to talk to the men in the room, and Andy Kaufman led this morning off with a discussion about how to deal with people in your stakeholder community who are a little bit difficult. And he mentioned a book called Good Guys. And I kind of laughed because the people who are reading the book Good Guys are frequently already good guys, because the book is about how to be better allies for your women colleagues. And of course, Sandy's reading it because he starts from there. But one of the things he talks about is that there are things that men don't always see that they do, and sometimes they don't have a language for it. He talked about centering in particular as an example. And in that, he said the head of the table isn't actually the power position. The middle of the table is. And I remember thinking back to pictures I've seen of presidential cabinets. The president always sits in the middle of the table. So if you were to offer to the men in the room one thing that would help them become even better good guys, but also something that can help those folks who are a little bit introverted, a little bit more reserved, whether, you know, male or female. So two hints, what would they be? Become more of a good guy and, you know, honor who you are as an introvert and a reserved person, but at the same time, make sure that your leadership is felt at the power that it actually deserves.
This is sort of antithetical in my response, because my response is soften your stance as a man. I say that because now I don't know how many of you have seen that video that I submitted to Kimi with the other gentleman. Ken Grady is in the video. He is CIO, and he always gets the feedback that people think he's aloof and standoffish and not approachable. And if you've seen the video, he's like so approachable and so funny and very welcoming. And so he's had to soften his approach and smile more and actually lean in. His favorite tool is, tell me more about that. You know, exactly. Tell me more about that. You notice how I'm leaning in when I'm doing it? Okay. So he's softening, saying, tell me more about that. So it's weird. It's antithetical. How do you be a leader but be softer? But it's been working for men.
Well, now, by the way, just so you know, Elaine and Ken both, Elaine went to Ken and said, is it okay if we do this? He said, absolutely. Made a gift of that video for the video library that is part of your leadership-driven project management initiative account. So for those of you who have registered for your free trial, you do have access to that interview. And I would seriously consider not just watching it, but I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm going to ask you to share that viewing time with somebody that you know that you think would benefit from some of the discussion and suggestions, because Elaine and Ken also talk about the value of, importance of, and the delivery and receipt of candid feedback. And that's tough sometimes. So last question before we go on a quick, please do not let food coma kill you break. Elaine, what do to solicit feedback? I mean, you and I have known each other for ages and ages. You can just call me and say, okay, Kimi, this is what happened. This is what I did. And what do you think? And I will call you and say, okay, I don't understand how this happened this way. But what if it's someone that you don't have that kind of relationship with? How do you elicit feedback that is candid and actionable?
You tie right back to the be bold right? Your being bold doesn't have to be your being bold on the outside. Your being bold on the inside, right, to be able to ask for feedback. So in the sense of, I don't really know you that well, you know, I would simply preface it as, one of my goals this year is to improve by asking for feedback. Can I ask you for feedback on how I did today?
Okay.
Yeah. So, and Bobby, I see your message. So your question is, any suggestions on how to be confident and approachable at the same time? That's a hard one. So the first thing I would say is you're going to have to practice one or the other first to then get the combo. Yeah. So I would try first the approachable, being more approachable, right? And being more approachable is being open. Interestingly, the eye contact and the smiling will help, right? Also, asking first. So let me try to give you a quick tip really fast. I have been a consultant for many years, and it's only been maybe the past 4 years. I've stayed at a company more than 2 years. Three was my max. I've had 4 years now at Audi of America. My number one goal was to be and have lunch with every single member of my team within the first 30 days. So be approachable. Make the meeting. Bring yourself. Give a little bit of you, right? To give a little bit of you first. Then they will give something back.
I have to admit, I really hadn't realized it until now, but for about the past 8 months, I keep waiting for the new job announcement from you. And I didn't realize that it was because I've kind of been preset for about a 2 to 3 year time.
Yeah. So, yeah. So, it feels weird. You're like, shouldn't she be moving now? Right.
No, but you've had some really big teams. So when you say that you had as a goal to have lunch with every single member of team in the first 30 days.
Yep.
Sometimes of your teams have coffee. Already. Yeah, they've been international. So you've already been doing virtual lunches with your team members already.
Yeah. So, you know, back in the day where, you know, I worked at Gap and it was the whole floor, it would be 10-minute coffee, 10-minute snack, a lunch with somebody, a walk to the BART station with somebody. Like, I fit it in everywhere. Right. So, yeah. As a consultant, right, you only have so much time to get that bonding. And so use every minute of it in every day. So that's why try the approachable one first. And you might need to find the one thing that you're always happy to share. Something that anyone who saw you on the street would know, like you're going to coffee and like, you know, how do you like your tea? Well, I like my tea like this. And just like, I'm a dog lover. Like, I will just warn you now that every time someone talks about their dog, I'm going to stop and say, like, what's your dog's name? And how long have you had them? And I got to leave early to go to my dog. Like, you know, talk about something that, you know, you don't mind that's public, that, and just use it. And in 10 minutes from now, when you go to the next person, you have to use the same topic. They don't know. Right? They don't know that you just used it, and then you'll get better at it, right? So do the approachable one, because what will happen is through word of mouth, people will now begin to say, she's really approachable, right? Like, she met everybody on the team in the first 30 days and talked about who she was and shows how open she is. And the real mastery of that is knowing when to listen. Stop talking and listen to what they're saying. So that's the really hard part, because you're practicing and you're practicing and you're practicing about your own approach. And then you have to go, wait, stop, listen.
This also ties into something that Marty had written about, I think, just getting back to being who you are intrinsically, who you are genuinely. She was, you know, I never really thought of myself. And Marty, correct me if I'm misquoting you here, is that I never really thought of myself as short. I don't even see myself that way. I never wear tall heels. Better to be me. On that note, first of all, Thank you, Elaine. It's always a pleasure to be able to talk with you, but I also hold this particular topic near and dear to my heart for a lot of us, whether it's because of internal reserve or because of gender or because of background. We're not as, quote, what's the phrase, out there. I hate that phrase. We're not as ebullient or perhaps as effusive as a lot of other people in the room, but that doesn't mean that we aren't still able and competent and willing to take the lead to help solve the problems that our organizations face. And part of that problem sometimes is helping people to see the value of our leadership. So thank you very much